The production of this video was made possible by donors to the Orchestration Online Patreon initiative. Please consider adding your support to the creation of free educational internet resources by visiting our Patreon page linked below. Welcome once again to the massive open online orchestration course. I'm your instructor, Thomas Goss. By this seventh lesson, we've covered a lot of ground scoring the major genres, from unaccompanied works to duos and trios. We're getting very close to the ultimate chamber music genre, the string quartet. But before we do, we have one more form to cover using piano, the piano quartet. In some ways, we can look at this as the logical conclusion to a certain thread that's run through this course. In Lesson 2, our first exercise combining instruments was the violin-piano duo. By Lesson 4, we'd added a cello to that duo to study the piano trio. Now that we've studied unaccompanied viola and the string trio, we're ready to take on the very elegant and expansive form of the piano quartet. Though this might seem to be the simple addition of one more voice, piano quartets tend to be somewhat different in approach than piano trios, as we'll see in this lesson's lecture. We won't be returning to the piano as an ensemble instrument for some time in this series of MOOC courses. All the same, here's a chance for the student to explore textures and episodes that can resemble the scope and intensity of an orchestral arrangement. I recommend that you make the most of it, as the craft of scoring piano in a chamber ensemble is extremely important for the working composer. Once you establish a toolbox of proven strategies, you can develop them in the context of larger ensembles like piano quintets and sextets, and from there to mixed chamber groups and reduced orchestras. I've scored many reductions of larger works using the piano as a member of such ensembles, and often it's the only way that a theatrical work can get a performance. So let's study how to do it the right way, with some of the keenest composers who ever contributed to the form. The first thing that I look at as a professional orchestrator is the instrumentation. What individual lines will result from a group of players, and what's the collective texture? How can it be altered, varied, and contrasted? In this case, for the past few lessons, we've given extensive study as to how each of our string components operates individually, how they relate to each other as a trio, and how they combine with piano. Every one of those approaches can apply to strong piano quartet scoring. The individuality of each instrument can shine with intelligent scoring, as we saw in the unaccompanied scoring lessons. The relationship of soloist to accompanist, or partnership of equals, in violin-piano duos, also applies to any other string member. Passages with solo viola and piano, and even more commonly solo cello and piano, are abundant in such scoring, along with the obvious tendency of violin to take the lead. Also, let's not forget that a piano quartet is essentially a piano plus a string trio. Everything that applied to string trio scoring approaches can also apply here, depending on the meaning of the music. The roles of support and alliance may exist alongside the piano, or fully integrate with it. Thank you. Quite often, all three string instruments may combine in melodic, harmonic, or rhythmic gestures, setting up a functional contrast with the piano. This is so effective that it's essentially the default position of a lot of scoring, but try not to overuse it all the same. Most of the great piano quartets were written by accomplished pianist composers. They can embody the character of a piano concerto, with extended solo passages contrasted by ensemble support from the strings, as if the trio were standing in for an orchestra. As we'll see, some trios could easily be rescored into concert pieces for piano and orchestra, as the scope can tend towards the epic. In the case of Schubert, this is about the closest he ever got to a piano concerto. Let's explore these general approaches in the context of the evolution of the form. The piano quartet emerged around the same time as the piano trio. Though Haydn never composed one in his otherwise extensive catalog of works, other composers of his time experimented with the form along the same basic lines as Haydn's early piano trios. The strings were there mainly to enhance the piano scoring, underlining rhythmic emphasis, harmony, and doubling the melody. A standout example of this approach can be found in Beethoven's three piano quartets, all written in the mid-1780s when he was around 14 years old. Beethoven looks forward to additional complexity, with counter-rhythms and the occasional independent episode for strings, but he never quite crosses the line. He's far ahead of earlier piano quartet composers such as J.C. Bach and Johann Schobert, but his own highly developed style is in its infancy here. While that's a great preview of things to come 12 years later and more in his piano trios, Beethoven had no idea the levels of artistry to which Mozart was about to raise the piano quartet in the very same year of 1785. As with the string trio and piano trio, while Mozart didn't invent the form, he evolved it so thoroughly that all other examples from that point on would have to build from his innovations. Mozart saw clearly that the piano could both lead and contrast with its string partners, who themselves could develop complex textures and functions without any piano involved. As with his string trio scoring, he's wonderfully generous to the viola part, and his scoring stands as a model as how to inject interest and dialogue into a middle voice. Let's score read the first movement of Mozart's Piano Quartet No. 1 in G minor, Kirchhoff 478, from the opening all the way to the first repeat. As we go, look for how Mozart applies all the scoring strategies we've been studying in this series. The intelligence of the phrasing, the aptness of the registers used, and the alliances between instruments. What are the accompaniment styles, and how do they propel the music? How do voice crossings and the strings play a part? How do close and open voices play a role? I'll add a few notes as we go along, but let's listen to a score that helped change the entire direction of chamber music. ¶¶ As successful as that score may seem today, it met with great resistance when it was first composed and performed. Let's not forget that chamber music at that time was part of a collaboration between wealthy amateurs and the itinerant musicians who taught them and played with them in evening soirees. The first performance of this work showed that it was far too difficult in both technique and structure for the average music enthusiast, and would require musicianship of the highest order for any kind of satisfactory performance. The publisher who had ordered 3 piano quartets from Mozart canceled the remaining 2 commissions and let Mozart keep his advance. Nevertheless, Mozart composed a second quartet within a year, and these 2 laid the cornerstone for the entire form from this point on. After listening to that, you can see that it's really a shame that Beethoven didn't compose any mature piano quartets. Not even his transcription of the Opus 16 Quintet for Piano and Winds really explores the kind of mastery he achieved in his piano trios. What's more, during his lifetime, only a few stray quartets of any notoriety were composed. One of this was the Adagio and Rondo of Schubert that we took a brief look at a few minutes ago. Another was Carl Maria von Weber's piano quartet of 1809, written when the composer was around 23 years old. Looking over the score, you can see that Weber treats his piano part in a soloistic way, even more than Schubert. In fact, in Weber's small handful of chamber ensemble works like the piano quartet and the clarinet quintet, he tended to treat the visiting performer as a dominant soloist, as if he couldn't get his head around Mozart's more egalitarian treatment of his parts. But this may simply have been a reality of his times, that few chamber works might get a listen in his artistic circles unless one particular player could carry the show and ensure a decent audience turnout. Weber was nothing if not a hardened professional musician, conducting operas from his late teens. This MOOC lesson's assignment will gravitate towards Mozart's type of integrated scoring, but Weber's quartet is worth a look. Though Weber was one of the first romantics, along with Schubert and Beethoven, this quartet is composed more along the sparkling late classical model, with the exception of a few very unorthodox modulations. A couple of decades later, Mendelssohn was just starting to publish the accumulated works of his mid-teens, and his opus numbers 1, 2, and 3 were all piano quartets. All are quite enchanting, but there's no denying the steady evolution of style and craft from one to the next. While the first and second quartets are very much along the lines of Weber and Schubert, the third quartet turns the corner towards a very mature approach, with much more integrated scoring of the strings. This solidly romantic, intensely disciplined approach looked forward to the monumental works to come by Schumann and Brahms. Thank you. With all that energy and drama, you'd think that more piano quartets might be composed by Mendelssohn after that, and that this new way of looking at the form might lead to greater efforts by other composers of that time. But the truth is that piano quartets had gained something of a reputation for being a difficult idiom in which to compose. That reputation remains to this day, solemnly repeated in program notes by music journalists who really should know better. They use terms like ungainly and overbalanced. There was also the effort of getting together that extra violist to add to your piano trio, a player who had to be very good in their own right in order to keep up. Or, if you were working with an established string quartet, you had to come up with a very good reason why the second violinist should give up his seat and his pay, so the others might play your piano quartet, when all four musicians could be engaged to perform in a piano quintet. And so, despite the promising example of Mendelssohn's third quartet, the form languished for another couple of decades. All of this changed after Robert Schumann's marriage to Clara Schumann, one of the greatest piano virtuosos of the 19th century. Their idea of time well spent was to look through chamber music scores, reading and playing through works by Mozart, Beethoven, Schubert, and other composers of the past few decades. Inspired by this, Schumann undertook a solid year of chamber composition in 1842, writing three string quartets, then a piano quintet, and finally a piano quartet. The quintet is much better known, probably because Clara took it on the road as a showpiece. While that's certainly terrifically exciting work, it's the piano quartet that really represents a huge evolution of the form. It's remarkable that such a piano-centric composer took the time to overcome his natural impulses and really elevate the string parts to true equality and partnership with the piano. From a scoring standpoint, it's possibly his greatest work, and unquestionably one of the pinnacles of chamber music composition. From the very beginning, Schumann makes it clear that the strings and piano are on thoroughly equal footing. In the introductory bars, the strings solemnly and elegantly state the theme, with just the tiniest bit of support from the piano, which is marked down dynamically to pianissimo. Then when the allegro finally starts, it's a series of joint declamations, with some icing in between from the piano. As the movement gets underway, look at who leads and who supports. It's just as likely to be any string player as it is the pianist. Schumann was a master of accompaniment styles, and he explores some great ways for the piano to support and propel the strings. Thank you. The scherzo is one of those movements that could easily become the assignment of an orchestration lesson. The staccato piano feels like pizzicato when teamed up with the cello, and certain passages that follow suggest other orchestral textures. All of that aside, it's a great expression of Schumann's sense of the relentless, and is a great study in motion and energy. The Andante Cantabile third movement is the real heart of Mendelssohn's piano quartet, and is often interpreted as a love song to Clara. I'd go a bit further to say that it wasn't so much an offering to her, as it was a comment about their mutual affection. The way the cello makes an opening statement and is answered by the violin is surely one of the most poetic and poignant musical conversations ever scored. Nevertheless, the composer moves from reverie to innovation, scoring his next dialogue between the viola's yearning, reaching statements and the piano's syncopated line. If the violin really does represent Clara Schumann, then certainly the long passages of semiquavers in the second part of the Andante movement depicts her precociousness and virtuosity, not to mention a certain quality of curiosity about art and life. That might be one programmatic interpretation. In a practical sense, though, the passage gives the cellist 16 bars in which to tune his low C string down a whole step to B flat, so that he can play these earthy octaves in the coda. It's a rare but very effective use of scordatura in early romantic scoring, and worth a listen. But don't overuse this technique in your own scoring all the same. The finale elevates this work of artistic evolution into an undeniable masterpiece. The part writing is exceptional throughout, as is the freshness of Schumann's ideas and the scope of their conception. The fugato, at the end, pulls an exquisite transcendent joke on the listener, building in both emotional and intellectual complexity, until the crux brings all elements to a brilliant resolution. Note how the integration of the parts is on a par with Mozart, and really raises the bar for all future attempts at piano quartet form. It's not to be wondered that Schumann's best friend and protege, Johannes Brahms, took over the cause of serious piano quartet scoring. Shortly after Schumann's death, Brahms started work on a series of three piano quartets, two of which were completed by the early 1860s. All three matched Schumann's quartet in craft, ingenuity, and freshness of ideas, while even further advancing the integrity and equality of scoring parts. Within Brahms's own lifetime, everyone's favorite was the first quartet, the G minor, and that preference remains to this day in chamber concert programming. You should study all of these piano quartets if you're serious about mastering the form, but for our lesson in this MOOC, I'd like you to turn your attention most strongly to the third quartet, Opus 60 in C minor. The composition of this quartet was started around the same time as the first two, and was the only concert work Brahms ever conceived in an openly programmatic context. In this case, he based the work on Goethe's biographical novel, The Sorrows of Young Werther, in which a young artist falls in love with a woman married to an older man. Apparently, the subject became too painfully associated with his personal closeness to Clara Schumann after her husband's death, and he set the piece aside for 15 years before completing it in 1875. To my mind, it takes the piano quartet as far as it can possibly go in the direction of Brahms's intensely intricate approach, and rivals his symphonies in scope of conception. In fact, there's something intensely symphonic about this work. It's the ultimate result of integrated scoring. Going beyond simpler concerns like thematic statements and contrasts of register, Brahms created a work in which all parts are working together to explore and develop themes and moods to forge an emotional bond between players and listeners. It's a work that's dark, rich, intense, and full of inner meanings. Thank you. In a kind of preview to the treatment of his second piano concerto, Brahms's third piano quartet has a monumental second movement scherzo, nearly dwarfing the first movement in intensity. Its final bars are so emphatic that they almost demand a curtain call and an encore all on their own, despite the fact that they occur only halfway through the entire piece. That premature finale is worth studying if you want to observe rich, full-blooded, and yet perfectly balanced scoring at its best. Those symphonic-sounding passages come with a price. The individuality of parts is sacrificed for long sections. This is remedied somewhat in the Andante third movement, a kind of echo of Schumann's Andante that we studied a while ago. In this case, though, the cello starts high and stays high in the tenor register for the most part, in the vocal range of a younger man, perhaps, rather than Schumann's more baritone-pitched cello solo. Likewise, the answering violin line is pitched a bit lower in the range of a wiser, more mature woman. All possible symbolism aside, the movement is also quite generous to the viola, allowing it to speak out rather than stay limited to a middle voice role throughout.
Thank you.
I love how the fourth movement brings everything together. The symphonic quality of scoring, and yet a knowingness of colors and roles that could be either taken individually for their own sake, or suggestive of deeper orchestral scoring in another sense. There's much to be learned here from the freedom of imagination and yet intense discipline that Brahms brings to bear. After the piano quartet scoring bar was raised by Schumann and Brahms, other 19th century composers applied themselves with more seriousness to the form. These included Saint-Saëns, Mahler, Dindy, Richard Strauss, and Chausson. Their quartets are all worth studying, and all have compelling scoring approaches. But let's finish this lesson with two works of superb craft and originality, Fauré's first piano quartet and Dvorak's second. Dvorak's first piano quartet mirrors Schumann's in a way, extremely optimistic and composed at the start of a happy marriage. But Dvorak's second piano quartet is much more mature and disciplined in craft. It's no wonder that Brahms became one of his strongest supporters, as works such as this one built on Brahms's approach, but incorporated a strong sense of Central European folk music and contemporary life. Though the outer movements are gripping, and the second movement adagio quite stirring, the most popular movement is the witty, urbane scherzo that evokes the delicious café lifestyle of the time. Note how Dvorak exchanges roles between piano and strings, with one supporting the other and then vice versa to contrast moods as well as timbral colors. This movement is an extremely quotable piece of 19th century music, and may very well be the best-known bit of piano quartet scoring ever. Thank you. On the other hand, Gabriel Fauré's first piano quartet seems to mirror Brahms's third in conception. Composed as the result of romantic distress, in this case, the breaking off of a long courtship and engagement. Fauré pours out his objections in page after page of passionately, intelligently scored music, incidentally establishing himself as one of France's greatest composers in possibly his finest chamber work. He was the artistic godfather to four key composers of the next generation, Debussy, Ravel, and Nadia and Lili Boulanger. And at times, the scoring very cautiously opens the doorway to Impressionism, while still maintaining Fauré's unique voice. Don't let that voice bewitch you, though. Look at the impressive craft he uses to communicate his ideas. The whole quartet maintains this level of lyricism and intrigue, and it's full of memorable episodes. On the grounds purely of studying scoring, perhaps the most individual is the opening of the Adagio movement, where the cello's melody is gradually doubled and then tripled in unison by the other strings, for a very dense yet raw sound. It's uniquely poignant, honest music, and Fauré's ex-fiancée must have had a heart of stone if she didn't feel some regrets after hearing it. The unfolding terzet in the strings that follows over a stuttering heartbeat piano accompaniment shows how the perfect placement of registers allows a complex arrangement to speak with clarity. Thank you. Throughout this course, I've focused on specific approaches while encouraging you to score in your own idiom and artistic voice. In this lesson, though I've pointed out how many approaches work in the context of different examples, I've tried to keep some of the focus on how each composer's musical personality and personal circumstances affected the character of their scoring. So I'm going to turn the tables somewhat in this lesson's assignment. Yes, I want you to apply all that we've learned in the past lessons and in this lesson about instrumental roles of leading and support, of texture and accompaniment style, and of registral and timbral qualities. You should have a higher level of familiarity by now of all string instruments involved, so that certain simple errors of approach are now behind you. But here's the point at which all this craft has to work for you. You have to let your growing level of skill and information start to guide the formation of your ideas toward a greater sense of confidence and maturity. So your assignment this week is to compose a 2 to 3 minute work that's a study in your own individual identity as an artist. Feel free to experiment with approaches, but those experiments should personify your own sense of curiosity rather than representing throwaway tests. Composers so often think of craft as a means to an end, but they rarely think of the craft itself shaping their own perceptions and level of inspiration. As we saw in the development of this very form, the piano quartet, scoring approaches can lead the way to a much deeper understanding of an artist's capabilities. You're going to need that understanding when we take on the final lesson of this first MOOC course, the string quartet. So rise to the challenge here, and you'll be ready for that last step toward mastery of string scoring.